problems with Hermione, and as for Dora, Charlotte, and Julia, they never left London except to go to fashionable resorts on the Riviera. The peril of a visit from any of them was so remote that it could be dismissed. His brother Galahad had once said that it had been a mistake to have sisters, and that they ought to have set their faces against it at the outset. But almost as good as no sisters were sisters who kept their distance. There was just one small, crumpled rose leaf. His younger son, Frederick, now employed in a New York firm which manufactured dog biscuits, had, most unnecessarily, sent this chap Chesney to him with a letter of introduction, and he'd had to ask him to stay. But he'd neutralized the man's menace by cleverly having all his meals in the library, and in between meals keeping out of his way. He finished the roly-poly pudding to the last speck of jam, and took his coffee to the armchair in which he always reclined when in the library. Selecting a volume from the shelf of pig books, his main source of mental refreshment, he'd just become immersed when through the open window came the sound of a car drawing up at the front door. It alarmed him. Shortly afterwards, Beach appeared.
"Was that a car, Beach?"
"Yes, my lord. It's her ladyship, my lord."
"What ladyship?"
"Lady Constance, my lord."
For one awful moment, Lord Emsworth thought he'd said Lady Constance. When he realized that this was indeed what Beach had said, his lordship quivered with resentment. Then the mist before his eyes cleared, and he saw in the eyes that met his a look in which sadness, understanding, and pity were blended. It convinced Lord Emsworth. He no longer felt that he'd been cast in the role of straight man supporting a butler who was playing for laughs. Hideous though the truth was, it couldn't be evaded.
Where is she?
In the amber drawing-room, my lord. Her ladyship is accompanied by a Miss Poke. From her voice, I gather, of American origin.
The pig book had long since fallen from Lord Emsworth's nerveless hand, as had the pince-nez from his nose. He reeled the latter in at the end of their cord.
I suppose I'd better go down.
With faltering steps, he made for the door. Beach, who sometimes read historical novels, was reminded of an apprehensive aristocrat in the days of the French Revolution on his way to the tumbril. Lady Constance was indeed in the amber drawing-room, sipping sherry and looking as formidable and handsome as ever. All Lord Emsworth's sisters were constructed on the lines of the severer type of Greek goddess, except Hermione, who looked like a cook. Connie, in particular, was remarkable for aristocratic hauteur and forcefulness of eye.
"Oh, there you are, Clarence," she said,
and her eye told him more plainly than words could have done that he'd failed to satisfy her fastidious taste in the matter of dress. Lord Emsworth was wearing, at the moment, patched flannel trousers, a ragged shirt, a shooting coat with holes in the elbows, and bedroom slippers. These, of course, in addition to the apprehensive look always worn by him when entering this formidable woman's presence. From childhood she dominated him, as she would have dominated Napoleon, Attila the Hun, and an all-in wrestling champion.
"Clarence, I want you to meet my friend Vanessa Polk, who was so kind to me on the boat. Vanessa, this is my brother, Clarence."
"And don't go blaming me," she seemed to be adding. "It's not my fault." Vanessa Polk's warmth and geniality were obvious at a glance. Where Lady Constance had winced at the sight of Lord Emsworth, like a Greek goddess finding a caterpillar in her salad, Vanessa smiled upon him, as if their meeting were something to which she'd been looking forward for years. It was a wide, charming smile, and it brought about a marked improvement in his morale. He felt, as so many people did when smiled upon by Vanessa Polk, that he'd found a friend.
"How do you do?" he said. "Welcome to Blandings Castle. Tomorrow I must show you my pig."
This was not an invitation he often extended to female visitors, for experience had taught him that the Empress was wasted on their shallow minds. But here, he saw, was one worthy of the privilege.